friends, moving on to our next topic, which is enclosed space entry. Now, enclosed space entry is a very important topic with respect to second mate orals. Now, this is a very important question. If you have answered any wrong answer to this question, would lead you to another attempt. So please revise it and be thorough with this topic, as there have been many lives which have been lost at sea due to enclosed space entry, non-improper procedures which have been followed at sea while entering enclosed spaces. So this is the right procedure. I'll be talking about what enclosed space entry is, what are the definitions you need to be thorough with for this topic, as well as what procedures to be followed while entering an enclosed space, what are enclosed space entry permits, and its validity. So let's start. Now, enclosed space entry. Now, what is an enclosed space? Enclosed space means a space which has any of the following characteristics. Number one, limited opening for entry and exit. Number two, unfavorable natural ventilation. That means it may be having a toxic atmosphere, maybe poisonous gases may be present, flammable mixture within the atmosphere may be present, and ventilation, not unfavorable natural ventilation is there. Number three, is not designed for continuous worker occupancy. So these are those spaces which are not designed for continuous worker occupancies. So those spaces are enclosed spaces. Now, this may include, but the list is not limited to, cargo spaces, double bottoms, your fuel tanks, ballast tanks, compressor rooms, pump rooms, cofferdams, void spaces, duct keels, etc. So these are what enclosed spaces, and this is the definition for enclosed space. The next definition under the enclosed space topic are adjacent connected spaces. As the name suggests, adjacent connected space, this is a space which is adjacent to your enclosed space. Okay, so this is an unventilated space which is not used for cargo, but which may share the same atmospheric characteristics as an enclosed space. So for example, this space may be such as a cargo space accessway. A cargo space accessway is an example of adjacent connected spaces. Our next definition is of a competent person. Who is a competent person? A competent person means a person with sufficient theoretical knowledge and also practical experience to make an informed assessment of the likelihood of a dangerous atmosphere being present, or the likelihood of a dangerous atmosphere being arising in the space. So that is a competent person. Usually a competent person includes all the officers, all the top four rank officers are competent persons. Coming to responsible person. Now, responsible person is a person who authorized to permit entry into an enclosed space. So usually it is the master who is a responsible person and who is having sufficient knowledge of the procedures to be established and complied with on board in order to ensure that the space is safe for entry. So a responsible person includes your top four officers, but usually it is the master who authorizes the permit to entry into an enclosed space. So this is a basic introduction to enclosed space entry. So friends, the first and foremost point which comes under enclosed space entry is that you must never enter an enclosed space without informing a responsible person and without receiving authority to enter the enclosed space. So usually your responsible person, as we have discussed, is the master. So without informing the master and without receiving the authority to enter an enclosed space, you must never enter an enclosed space. Then note the information on the procedures to be followed to enter the enclosed space can be found on board. Where all can it be found on board? This is another question which is asked by the surveyors. So it can be found in your safety management system. Number two, maritime safety card. Number three, ship's quality assurance scheme. Number four, ship's permit to work system. So these are the places on board where you will find the procedures for entering an enclosed space present on board. Rest, the revised recommendations for entering enclosed space aboard ships can be found from the IMO's resolutions, which is Assembly Resolution A.105027. So usually most of the topics which I have covered is through this resolution. You can go through it for additional information. next topic is, what are the hazards which are associated with enclosed space? The hazards associated with enclosed space are as follows. Number one, oxygen deficiency. Number two, inert gas including nitrogen. Number three, presence of toxic and flammable gases. Number four, accumulation of toxic and heavy gases at the lower levels within the space, and oxygen enrichment. So these are the five hazards associated with enclosed space. Now, oxygen deficiency. How does oxygen deficiency take place? Now, when a confined space is left unventilated for a prolonged period, what happens is the oxygen within the space is used up in the oxidation process or the rusting process which takes place. That is where the oxygen gets depleted and the atmosphere becomes hazardous, as oxygen below 21% is very hazardous, is quite dangerous to human health. Then inert gas including nitrogen. Inert gases, where the compartments are used, are filled with inert gases such as nitrogen. So in those spaces also the oxygen content is less. Then presence of toxic and flammable gases. Now when a cargo compartment, you're carrying cargo such as animal oil or vegetable oils or any other cargo in which your decomposition may take place, fermentation or a slow oxidation process may take place, in which oxygen depletion occurs, and releasing of in fermentation and fermentation processes releases H2S, carbon monoxide, methane. So as you know, these gases are heavier, some gases are heavier, some are light. I'll explain you what happens is methane. Let's consider this as the cargo space. Now methane is lighter than air, so it will be present in the top. Carbon monoxide is same as air, so it may be present over here. And then you have H2S, hydrogen sulfide, which is heavier than air, which would be present in the bottom space. So this is how the gases are accumulated. Accumulation of toxic or heavy gases at the lower levels within the space. And oxygen enrichment. Oxygen enrichment is hazardous, as oxygen in a when it is more than 21%, if it is it reaches to 24%, for example, it may lead to fire, generation of fire within the compartment. More metals and cargos are prone to burn or are prone to flammability when there is a high level of oxygen present. So this is the hazards which are associated within an enclosed space. Coming to factors which are identified for accidents in enclosed spaces are as follows. Now, non-compliance with procedures. This has to be the first and foremost point. Non-compliance with procedures. Poor supervision by officers. Compliance, complacency and over-familiarity leading to shortcuts being taken. So don't be overconfident. Even if you have the knowledge and experience, please follow the procedure. Then monitoring equipment are not used. Monitoring equipments are not used. The equipments which are required, such as multi-gas detector, oxygen analyzer, etc., which are not used or are not working properly. Then improper action in an emergency. A person who goes into an enclosed space, maybe he has fallen unconscious, and seeing this, you go to save him, and even you also fall unconscious due to the atmosphere present over there. So remember, you have to take proper action. The proper action which is required during such an emergency has to be taken. Do not make yourself prone to the disaster which has occurred. So these are the factors which are identified for incidents, for accidents in enclosed spaces. So the next topic is enclosed space entry. Now for enclosed space entry, I have defined 5 star points. The first star is isolation. Second star, gases. Third star, ventilation. Fourth star, illumination. Fifth star is the communication. So these are the 5 stars which will help you to remember the procedures while entering enclosed space. Isolation of the compartment is really important, or the confined space has to be isolated. If it's a ballast tank, It has to be isolated by the valve has to be isolated and tagged properly so that inadvertent activation of such valve doesn't takes place when a person enters the ballast tank. Then also check for gases. The atmosphere has to be checked for toxic gases, poisonous gases. You have to make those checks with the help of tank scope, your multi-gas detector, oxygen analyzer, toxic gas detectors, etc. Then comes ventilation. Now ventilation of the space has to be done prior entry, and it has to continue when you are entering. Ensure 21% of oxygen content is present in the atmosphere. Sufficient illumination is present, and communication equipments are present. So these are the 5-star points for enclosed space entry. We'll be discussing in details regarding the enclosed space entry. And also remember, a new amendment has come regarding the drills for enclosed space entry. At least one enclosed space entry drill has to be conducted at least once every 2 months. So enclosed space entry drills are mandatory, need to be conducted once in every 2 months. Friends, the first step in enclosed space entry is isolation. Now, cargo or ballast need to be pumped out prior entry. Number two, notices to be displayed at the entrance of pump room. This is to restrict and prohibit entry without permission. Number three, designated valves to be tagged for enclosed space entry. This is to prevent inadvertent opening of such valves. And you have to ensure the proper isolation of the tank. This is done where the bridge as well as the engine room are kept informed, and they work in coordination to ensure the proper isolation of the tank. Moving to step 2 in enclosed space entry is check for atmosphere or gases. So you can do these checks by using the following instruments, which is oxygen analyzer, explosive meter, multi-gas detector and a toxic gas detector. So what does oxygen analyzer is used to ensure that oxygen to be present is of 21% in the atmosphere of the confined space. The explosive meter used checks for the amount of combustible gases. The multi-gas detector checks for oxygen, hydrogen sulfide, methane, carbon monoxide, and also it gives the lower explosive limit in percentage. The toxic gas detector is used to ensure that no toxic gases are to be present in the confined space. These all instruments have to be well calibrated and in good working condition, tested regularly, and can be used to ensure the atmosphere is safe for entry. Now, please kindly read in detail regarding all the instruments and the procedures to use it. So friends, the next important question which is asked is, how will you detect the gases? So using the multi-gas detector, how are you going to detect those gases? So when you are using those multi-gas detector, will you wear a scuba set, and then along with the multi-gas detector, are you going to go into the space, and then are you going to check for different gases, or how are you going to go about it? So this is an important question which is asked by the surveyors. If you are going to give this answer, it is not confined to all the confined spaces. So in 4-peak tank, you cannot wear a scuba and enter, because 4-peak tanks are very confined and very jumbled. The construction of the 4-peak tank itself doesn't allow you to wear a scuba set and enter it. It's not appropriate. So how are you going to detect for the gases in a 4-peak tank for enclosed space entry? So how you'll do that is by using a multi-gas detector. Now the multi-gas detector, for example, this is the multi-gas detector, and these are the gases which it detects. For example, H2S, carbon methane, carbon monoxide, oxygen, then hydrocarbons, and lower explosive limit percentage. So this is what the gases detected by the multi-gas detector. It is connected to a electric pump. Now this electric pump is connected to a gas sampling hose. This is a gas sampling hose. So what you will be doing is you'll switch on the motor in this, the electric pump. You'll switch on the electric pump, the motor will be on, and the gas through and you'll check for the gases with the help of gas sampling hose. The length of the gas sampling hose is usually of 30 meters in length. This is of 30 meters in length. Hence, by putting the gas sampling hose into the confined space, you are going to check for the gases. So this is how you are going to do. Once you check for those gases, it is done in a stepwise. It is a stepwise process. For example, this is the confined space. Now you have checked for first 30 meters, then the next 30 meters, then next. You will go like this, because you can't go directly you can't check for all the full the whole compartment cannot be checked at once. So you'll check for one particular space is checked, you'll enter this space, then you'll check for this space, you'll enter this space, then you'll check for this space. In this way you do the gas checking, and you ensure that the place is safe for entering. Illumination. Now proper lighting has to be provided. Ensure adequate lighting has been provided. Point number 4, standby. Ensure that a person is standby outside the space in case of emergency. A person needs to be standby for a rescue operation to be carried out. And ensure that a breathing apparatus, stretcher, resuscitating equipment, a tripod recovery stand, and a lifeline are placed near the entrance to the space. So these are the equipments which are required to be placed at the entrance to the space. So this is another important question which is asked by the surveyor. Then step 5, authorization and checklist. Now, person entering to have informed and received authorization from a responsible person prior entry, that is the permit for enclosed space entry has to be received. The authorization permit for enclosed space entry from a responsible person has to be received. The responsible person usually is the master. Then the responsible person should ensure that the checklist for enclosed space entry has been properly followed and filled. So this is step number 5. Coming to point number 6, which is communication. Ensure that proper and adequate means of communication has been established between the person entering the enclosed space and the person who is on standby, as well as between the person who is on standby and the responsible officer. So this means of communication has to be established and has to be adequate. And number 7, validity of the entry permit. Now validity of the entry permit depends on the designated by the responsible person, who is usually the master. He decides on the validity of the entry permit from what hours to what hours it has to be. Usually it is a 12 hours permit usually, and this period should not be exceeded. So that is the validity of the entry permit, and these are all the steps which have to be followed in enclosed space entry.